Morning, Josh. How's it going, man?
Good morning.
Welcome to Sparkle Towers. Shut off the rip, but I know I ain't letting him slide. I just hope we can lie, cause if he got smoke, then it ain't no way he can hide. I just paid by the band for one of my tools. You think I won't up with that fire? I ain't wanna do this shit, but fuck it. Watch how I swallow my pride. I just came back from New York, got a deal from another label, but the other label said the other labels ain't do shit for their roster shit. So they told me don't sign. I know for a fact that. So we've got Josh into Sparkle Towers. We're gonna show you around. A lot of people have been asking where we're staying, also in Dubai. I think this is the best place I've stayed in terms of an Airbnb. So we'll take you around, show you what you can get for your money. Show you the view, which is fantastic here, and then we're gonna sit down and do a quick Q&A, and then we go hit push. So with this place, you get 3.5 bedrooms. They all come in this weird like maid's room, but there's 3 double bedrooms, all with en-suites. We've got 2 balconies. This is one of them, which serves 2 of the rooms. There's another one off the living room. They've got smart TV, which is good. The big thing for here is the Wi-Fi is good and it reaches every room, so that's really important. And as you can see, we're on the 27th floor with a crazy view, which is quite important, I think. When you stay in the marina, it's good to have a view. And this is the first place I stayed when I came to Dubai. The guy hits number 27 on the elevator, and I was thinking, sweet, we're going up top. So I think it's only 29 stories, and we're on 27, so it's good. But yeah, we're really happy with this place. Valet parking, that's a big one. And there's a car fort at the bottom. It's about a 5-10 minute walk down to JBR. If you know where that is, that's sort of the main beach around Dubai Marina. So there you go. Welcome to Sparkle Towers. So you've had a little tour. We're now going to just run through a few questions on a Q&A. Obviously got Lewy here, who's a bit of a mindset mastermind. So I'm going to hand some questions over to him. But we're going to start with a nice light-hearted one first, which is from Perrin Tustin, one of my favorite clients. What are the best and worst things in Dubai? I think the best thing about Dubai, or like a bit of a hidden pleasure for me, has been just driving around the place either at day or night in the Jeep Wrangler with the top off, playing Jack Harlow or Pop Smoke. That's like a hidden pleasure. I think if someone was like, what should I do if I go to Dubai? And I'm like, well, if you want something cheap to do, just drive 100%. Around. Because it's unreal. Like, it looks like a video game. Someone replied to my story the other day saying it looks like a video game. And I was like, yeah, it really does.
Grand Theft Auto,
yeah. Dubai City. Yeah. And then worst thing for me, I would just say that the way in which Dubai can completely consume you, and does completely consume a lot of people, like myself included, but the level of like pretentiousness that you can come across, I think especially now with what's going on in the UK, so many people have flown out, as you've seen, you've all seen the memes. But if you just walk down the pool at 5, it's like, wow, this is a new level of pretentiousness. So yeah, that's probably the worst thing for me, but I don't know about Lewy.
Yeah, I'd say the best thing is finishing up a session and then just being able to get in the sun. I think something I'll never take for granted here, compared to my post-workout routine at home.
Yeah.
Sat in the kitchen looking at it like, oh mate, this is crap. I would say the worst thing is trying to establish like a routine with food, to be honest. It's the thing I've struggled with the most here. When you get groceries in, and if you do a good shop with foods that you actually need to really consume, it is genuinely pretty much the same as getting something freshly made. And for me, that just bugs me. Someone at home who likes to try and spend like 40, 50 quid a max a week on food, you can do that easily nearly a day here, I'd say. If you're gonna get proper good food in too, so that's a bit of a bugbear for me.
Yeah, I would agree. I think my prep's coming up, and I definitely wouldn't want to go from not being on prep to starting prep here, because the lack of, I mean, I've just even managed to, I think since I've been here, and I've probably been here a total of 6 weeks now in terms of last time and this time, I think I've cooked, I can count on one hand the times I've cooked. It's just way too easy to order food in. And it can be good food, like you can see us go to low calorie at the gyms, you can get your chicken and rice meals made up, but there's just, I know what you mean, there's something about cooking, you feel like you're in the grind, don't you?
Yeah.
But out here, like, why would you cook when you could get out in the sun and just order food?
Yeah.
So I would agree on that one. I think if you're a hardcore bodybuilder at heart and you get a bit consumed by the sun and wanting to be out in it, that can be a challenge.
Yeah. That's me too. At home, every meal's cooked. And just the change in the weather, the environment, the convenience of it all, then I'm still there at the end of the day, like, oh, that's annoying. But I'm still making sure macros are hit, of course, and all that good stuff.
Yeah, macros are hit, body weight's not dropping, that's the goal for me at the moment, so just trying to eat enough.
Yeah.
So the next question is from Con Grams. It's foundations to setting up a daily journal entry, which I'm just going to get Lewy to answer because he's the mindset master.
So journaling for me, I think, is it needs to be personal, it needs to be something that resonates. However, I think a few sort of fundamental things to be putting in there each day. It's a shame that it's almost become a bit of a cliche now, and it is writing down something that you're grateful for each day. But the more deeper reasoning as to why you're doing that is you're training your perception to see more things to be grateful for as your day goes on. So at the start of it, you might feel a bit silly. You might think, oh, that was too simple, like for the simple thing of just like having a roof over my head, you know, having a good night's sleep. But then what you'll start to do is your paradigm will shift, because you're going to be like, right, in the back of my head, I know I need to do my gratitude at the end of the day or at the start of the day. So then you're going to start to look for things that you're grateful for, and it could be the most simple things. And that for me is where, if you can find gratitude in the most simple things, like for me, just going out for a walk in the sun, something which you may have taken for granted before and not even thought about. And why we want to do that? Because feeling grateful is a nice emotion to have. So for me, gratitude is always at the top of that. And then the second one is how I'm feeling today. Now, at the start, it can be a real struggle. You may write down one or two words like, I feel okay, you know, I feel happy. Once you start to open up that dialogue quite openly with yourself, and you really start to sit and think like, how do I genuinely feel today? Then you can start to ask your question, okay, so why am I feeling that today? So, okay, I'm feeling a little bit on edge today, or I'm not feeling quite myself today. And then you can start to feel like, okay, well, what's going on in my life right now? Okay, so lockdown. We know that everyone is going through lockdown at the moment. And then you can start to put tools in place. And so it just opens up dialogue. So how am I feeling is always a big one for me, whether it's good or bad. And then the third bit I put in is my intentions for the day. So basically, what tasks do I need to complete? So whether it's training related, business related, even interpersonal things. So like, it sounds silly, but making sure that you drop your friend a message today, like, I'm gonna message such and such today. Again, these things will generate a positive experience and make you feel better. Now, with all that said, if you need some guidance and it still feels a bit foreign, you can get journals which will have like questions for you to think about. So like 5-minute journal is a really good one. I highly recommend getting that. And it's 5-minute journal for a reason. It takes 5 minutes per day.
I actually have a bit of experience with this from going through some stuff this year. Therapy told me to crack on with a bit of a journal, and I found that actually just sitting there and truly thinking about how you're feeling for a minute gives you a whole other level of self-awareness. I think that's probably something that a lot of people lack. One thing I think Lewy didn't mention, which I don't know if he does or not, but just giving yourselves a minute or 2 minutes of guided breathing before you're doing it, because you can be all caught up in something and then you suddenly start scribbling something down. You need to like remove yourself from that situation and be like, okay, how do I actually feel at the moment? Give yourself a minute of guided breathing, bring your heart rate down, bring yourself present, and then start writing down all those things.
Yeah, definitely. Yep.
So I'm going to pull a last couple of questions together because I think they kind of come from the same place, and I think they can be answered with the same sort of answer. So number one is Tom Bradley 2, how to get into coaching. Number two is from Jack Mahler, which this is a meaty one. How to grow from nothing and stand out in the fitness industry when it's so saturated. Now, the fitness industry obviously is going on to be more and more saturated. I think it's the wrong way to look at it like that though. When you think about how many people there are in the world that need fitness, want fitness, will benefit from fitness, it's not saturated at all. You know, if you ever come across a coach who's like, oh, how am I gonna get any clients when everyone else is full of clients? There is billions of people in the world, and some of them don't even know what coaching is yet. So don't kind of think about saturation at the moment, just kind of, because that will just bog you down and you'll be thinking, how am I gonna break through? In terms of how I think I've broken through and how I've developed in this industry, it's a case of literally being myself, being true to myself, and staying true to that mission throughout, from beginning to end. Whether I knew what I was doing at the start, or as much as I know what I'm doing now, for me it was always about kind of calling out bullshit, not falling into that trap of just talking bullshit in the industry, posting motivational quotes, posting just regurgitating shit that everyone's seen day after day after day. And even more so now, it's that no-nonsense kind of approach to educating people, that no-nonsense approach to addressing what other people are putting out, that continues. So for me, a massive thing is I've seen a big gap in industry, in that I want to be someone who has a great physique but doesn't chat shit about how they got it, or got it the right way, an actionable way that someone else can get. It's not like, oh, hi, I'm an IFBB pro and I did it by doing 4x10-12 for the last 6 years. Like, I've actively looked out for the right places to learn. So you've heard Luke speak about this. Try and seek out the right places to learn in terms of industry. I would say the muscle mentors, I would say Joe Bennett, the hypertrophy coach, Eugene, the Gambari method, Muscle Doc. These are all great resources. Go to these guys, don't go to influencers. Okay, go to people whose true careers it's been for years and years and years to learn from the best. And that will set you apart, because immediately you have actual, genuinely like factual knowledge on how to hypertrophy, how to diet, how to run nutrition. So that's the first thing I'd say, is that educate from the right places and kind of stay true to being genuine. In terms of getting into coaching, actually, let me just backtrack a second, how to grow from nothing. Content is a massive one for me, and I think it's one that loads of people miss out on. A lot of my clients ask me, how do I grow my Instagram? How do I grow a following? For me, it's about making it look professional, having your profile look a certain way. That doesn't mean a row of three. That doesn't mean you need to buy a big camera. You know, iPhones are fantastic nowadays. What it means for me is, make sure your lighting's good. Make sure your background's clean. Make sure you're providing value in that content. Make sure you're taking photos in the right places, you know, not in front of a load of bins, for example. You know, take those photos in good places and make them attractive to look at. You know, at the end of the day, that's what Instagram's about. It's looking at something, it's being aesthetically pleasing. So that is a big one. And then in terms of getting into coaching, again, this is something I speak about a lot with clients. That would be about establishing yourself as early as you can. I wouldn't say take people on for free, because I don't think they invest in the service if it's free, but reach out to a few people that you know you think you might be able to help. Maybe get them to invest, but a smaller amount than maybe normal. You're gonna have to start with a low price. You need to start building up some social proof, showing people that you can help them, and explain that journey to people. Like, say, this is how John got from A to B. Don't just say, here's John's before and after, because quite often that before and after tells 1% of the story. You know, everyone wants that start to finish. But actually, what I think people really need to know, whether they want it or not, is how you get from A to B. You know, and someone might look the same in two pictures, but you might have completely changed their mindset on food. You might have taken them from 1,200 calories to 2,400. They can now go out, they can drink, they can socialize. So it's about telling people that journey in terms of how to get into coaching. Now, I think Lewy's journey is probably a bit different. I've tried not to touch on competing there at all. But Lewy, take it away.
Yeah, so like my journey was, it's very much like, I knew I wanted to sort of coach, but I knew that I didn't have enough prowess in terms of just straight up on socials. And I think trust is the big thing. That's what Joe was touching on. And I was thinking, how can I build trust and translate that over into Instagram? And I started to realize that the people trust people that when they know them, right? And how can I do that on Instagram? It was a bit of a slow burner. So I thought, well, the gyms I train at, these people are most likely going to know me and they're going to trust me. So I would just train at a gym and I would get to know as many people as I can. And again, with no expectations, I think that's the big thing, is like when you're genuinely just trying to make connections with people, you shouldn't have like a client at the back of your head. For me, when you're in the gym, you should just be trying to make connections with people. So I would train in sort of four or five gyms, and then off the back of that then allowed me to have content. So the sort of the loop that I'd get into is I'd be posting productive content, which is useful, whether it's training based, whether it's mindset based. And then whilst I'm in the gym, you can't be the person who's, you know, doing one top set, one back off set, hood up, you know, and not speaking to anyone. And then you're going to do a post in their gym. People are going to see it and you end up just becoming more that guy rather than the guy that people want to follow. So for me, it was like looking at it on a micro scale. And building up relationships around those gyms, and over time people were then going to go onto the content. They saw you in the gym, you know, he looked approachable, didn't speak to him, but he just looked like he was, I'm going to drop him a follow. They're going to be your people that then you have a bit more of an audience with. And I'm saying this is how I'd probably do it if I had, like, if there was zero following. That's me personal. And then in terms of that, it then builds up, and then incorporate what Joe said in terms of you can then get your first clients, and then the trust will build from there. Word of mouth is king. I'm sure you're the same, but I haven't spent £1 on advertising. It's just been word of mouth. And how you generate that. So I think, remember, you train at a gym. Just because you maybe want to do online, but you still see people every day when you walk into the gym, they're the people who are going to trust you first. And then, you know, a year or two may go by, and then you'll have people who will just follow your page and instantly trust you, and then purchase your service from there. So that's sort of my take on it.
I think there's a couple of things we can, just going off what Lewy said as well, two big things that I didn't speak about initially is one, obviously relationships, which Louis's spoken about a lot there. And that's not just with people in the gym as well, but that's with other people that are probably on the same journey as you. Stop thinking you're in competition with everyone. As I've said, there's billions of people in the world. You know, they might find you first, they might even find someone else first, but maybe they prefer your approach. I think that also comes back to just being yourself. You know, there are people that will follow me and all my peers, but they'll come to me because they're just like, listen, I just vibed with your Instagram. I liked what you were saying. I liked how you say it. I think you care. And then the other one is just like commitment. Don't expect it to happen overnight. I was speaking to Josh yesterday. He's been on Instagram for 9 years. He's now obviously at 40 something thousand followers, which is amazing. I've been doing it for 7 years and I'm on 17,000. You know, getting that first thousand, second thousand, it takes years and years and years.
Yeah.
And it may take one big moment for you to get a decent amount. I remember 10K was massive for me. Now I hope to get to 20K. Whilst followers aren't everything, every single follower you hope is a potential client. And that's probably the final thing I'll end on. In terms of interacting with people, everyone you speak to is a potential client. I will say that probably 60 to 70% of my current clients, I answer the question for them for free prior to them coming on board. So
definitely agree there.
So, so important.
Yeah.
And that goes in line with in person, it goes in line with your inbox. It's wherever you need to be approachable, you need to answer people's questions. If you don't know the answer, go and find it out or refer them to someone else.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's a pretty good roundup.
I think we're there, yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Smashed it. So we're now off to train SF, which we've not filmed that before. We're gonna hit push there. It's pretty decent for push. It's quite commercial. I think the lift's about to stop. Someone's gonna pop in. Hey, no boss. Just kidding, just start again. I'm gonna put that in.
No, carry on, you know.
So yeah, we're going to train SF, which is good for push. It's a bit of a commercial gym. You compare it to an England gym, it's kind of a high-end pure gym if you like, but they've got some decent Atlantis kit in there. Dumbbells unfortunately up to 60, so we'll put those a bit later in the workout, but it's a good gym, it's nice, it's got good lighting, they're happy with filming, so we'll head down there. It's just around the corner from Binus, whatever you want to call it, so we'll get in there, me and Lewy, and get after it.
Ever since Diesel put us on 2 till 4, yardie kick shit coming off the hinges. You can see the prints from the boots on the door. Jump on the stage like who won the war, not a you anymore. But don't get it twisted, I'm still a big kid. Might pull up in the whip with the windows tinted. Bags full of cash like Ricky and Ingrid. Got bad beats that'll make it clap for me. Got G's that'll make it clap for me. Push your wig back for me, told you don't disrespect the Lord. That's blasphemy.
Big down guys in the booth.
Seven.
Train with your life, don't act up again, you know that ain't really wise. Last time my brother's
never down here, train SF. We're gonna hit push. This is push 2 rotation with me and Lewy. He'll just be following my split for now. We're gonna head over there straight into pec fly and then we'll go into some presses. So let's get it.
Keep my name out your mouth, rude boy. You're a fan, better still, you're a stalker. Lick down guys in the booth, sniper, take out guys on the roof, take out crews, give man a deja vu, blood stop hiding the truth, do it in the basement, me against you, do it on stage, yeah, that's everyone against me, and we can pull up to the radio and do it.
So for me, particularly on a push day, in fact on any day, a push day in general, I think spending quite a lot of time with your warm-up is absolutely key. So some kind of pec fly, maybe a clavicular pec fly or a costal pec fly with the cuffs, you'll see us do that as well. But even just a machine pec deck, get on that machine, spend a good 2-3 sets feeding up to a top set. Forget about your hands on this movement. It's all about driving your elbows across to the midline, so adducting the elbow. And then something as well that I don't think many people do with a lot of movements, particularly important in a movement like this, where the resistance is trying to push you out, you've still got a nice amount of resistance here. So spend a bit of time in that shortened range. Keep trying to drive that chest across, even though you can't go anywhere because the machine's stuck there. That means there's so much resistance. So keep pushing across, in both hands, keep pushing across. Spend a bit of time in that shortened range. The pec's completely contracted. You're gonna be able to drive a really deep neurological connection, and that's what you want as you go into the rest of your push day.
Lick down guys in the booth, sniper, take out guys on the roof, take out crews, give man a deja vu, blood stop hiding the truth, do it in the basement, me against you, do it on stage, yeah.
Not sure where Joe's gone. I think the pre-workout might have gone through him a little bit.
Or we could pull up to the radio and do it how we did it on 923. Snipe up, but it's not Kung Fu style. Big DP, I've been here for a while. Been on the road, been putting in work since OGs. We're giving that Chelsea smile.
So again on this, similar concept to on the pec fly. The main motion I'm thinking about is elbow adduction.
me pushing those handles up with my hand is just a byproduct of me getting my elbow through to that midline. So once you forget about your hands and you start thinking about what the actual pec is there to do, which is horizontal elbow reduction, you get a whole different feeling and you'll connect with that movement a lot better. And the thing I see most of people doing this, if clients are sending me form videos of this movement or any pressing for that matter, is people are taking a grip where their wrists aren't aligned with their elbows. So you're pushing this, say you're pushing here, this is really inefficient. Get that elbow directly under the wrist, you're going to be a lot more efficient. You'll probably get yourself a lot less wrist issues as well, so that's another tip for that one.
And told me when I see them waist, man, wave it down. Wait, jump at the whip, wave it round. So many spent shells, cuts untold rounds. Man,
sweet. I said that.
We're in town, left it to them. Look at it now, everything that we built up, they burnt down. Do it like the basement or like the roof. You know the settings, don't need a booth. Nope. Just two decks, one mic and a mixer. Lyrics for lyrics like deja vu. I can build two beats, put them on loop. Spit two lyrics, everybody goes loop. If you can't feel a beat, then spit a lyric. King of the grime scene, that's not you.
Link down guys in the booth. Sniper, take out guys on the roof. Take out crews, give man a deja.
You've seen us do that before. Lewy doesn't need it. I've just got slightly longer levers. So for me to get into a position that's not compromising shoulder health, I'm going to put the D handles in. When I lift it up, they're going to drop out and I can get full range of motion. Again, on this movement, we've obviously not done a shoulder press yet, so we're going to do a few feeder sets. And something's going to touch on over there. With changing gyms, I think a lot of people are training in different places at the moment. Use feeder sets as your chance to feel out the machine. Work out how hard it's going to be, how heavy it's going to be. Work your way up in terms of weight, so maybe do 5 reps, maybe do 3 reps, maybe do 1 rep on a set that you think, oh, this could be a working set weight. If it flies up, you know you can put more weight on. So that's how we kind of work up what our working set weight's going to be when using different gyms, because that's not a machine that we use very often. Last feeder set on here, and then we jump in the top set back off. You know the drill.
Blood, stop hiding the truth. Do it in the basement, me against you. Do it on stage, yeah, that's everyone against me. And we can pull up to the radio and do it how we did it on 923.
Lick down guys in the booth. Sniper, take out guys on the roof. Take out crews.
Yes. Come on. Keep running that. Let's go. Again. Yeah, come on. Come on. It's all you, mate. It's all you. Come on with me.
Let's go.
Drive hard then. Come on. Come on. Fucking finish that. Come on. Come on, Lou. Let's get sticky. Come on.
Yes. Oh. Stuck there for a moment.
No, I'm good.
Let's go, come on. Come on, come on, at least you. Let's go, let's go. Good. Come on, come on. A little bit with me. Minuscule amount. Come on. Good. Keep that tempo. Let's go. Yes, mate. Come on. Boom. Yes. Good. Get up. Boom. Up.
So we're trying to create some kind of flat press here. There's a flat hammer strength press over there, pin-loaded one that is busy. So if we just shift our bum forward a bit, we can create essentially the illusion of it being a flat press. So pin-loaded flat press, 2, 8 to 12, nothing crazy on here. At this point, especially with a pin-loaded movement, I find it a lot easier just to connect with it all the way through. So that's what we're doing. This will be our last chest movement, and then delts and arms.
923.
Lick down guys in the booth. Sniper, take out guys on the roof. Take out crews, give man a deja vu. Blood stop hiding the truth. Do it in the basement, me against you. Do it on stage, yeah, that's everyone against me. Or we could pull up to the radio and do it how we did it on 923.
Machine lateral raise, similar to a lot of arm movements. What I'll do is the first set, I make it my lightest set, so 12 to 15 reps. It's still to failure, it's still relatively heavy. I'm gonna fail in that sort of higher rep range. The reason I think is just help me prime myself for my next set. It's gonna be a heavier one, so then now I'm gonna be 6 to 8, or 8 to 10. So this is gonna be a much heavier set. I'm gonna fail within that range again, but I've primed that muscle. So I'm not jumping straight into a heavy set where I'm gonna fuck up the form, it's gonna look messy. I'm going to prime myself, make sure I can get the most out of that heavy set, and then again, as usual, we'll back off at the end. The reason I favour machines as well over dumbbells, this is old news now, but if anyone's not heard it, with a dumbbell and a lateral raise, down here there's just no resistance to your delts. Think about gravity, think about where that weight wants to go. It wants to drop to the floor, so you're not fighting against anything here. As you go out, you begin to fight against something. With this, you've got resistance straight from the start. It's the same with a cable, cross-body cable raise. You've got resistance here in that lengthened range, which is probably where for years some of you have missed out. Resistance.
Judo with a man and wave. Told Zoo that I'm landing late. Gotta keep crafts and wax awake. Mention my name, that's a mad mistake. Got me feeling like Santan Dave. Got a high man hating at this age. In the tea house, got a bag this yay. Got boxes like Cassius Clay. My gang get paid, just shut down and set in a random place. In the ends with man like H, that's DE 24 Grampian Way. Niggas wanna shoot at me, best have the best shot like match of the day.
See how I need to go up and down? His wrist. Look how his wrist moves, watch how it moves. I don't believe Lewy's doing that on purpose, I believe that's how his wrist wants to move. If you're not using the D-handles, your wrist is just fixed. It's going to cause unnecessary stress to the wrist, unnecessary stress to the elbow, and ultimately you're going to be less efficient with pulling that weight as well.
100%.
So that's why we get the D-handles in there.
Previous using a bar, elbow would flare up almost instantly or the day after. So it allows just free movement, and bringing it in when I contract, allowing it to move.
If you think about when you'd be using a dumbbell, you typically wouldn't just be curling like this. People would curl as freely as they like. And quite often, many people will find that sort of internal rotation as they get their bicep short is going to contract it even harder. So multiple benefits using the D-handles. That's why I've done it with that. So I did it with the push-downs. And that's why they're a key part of our workouts. There we go, we've got another movement there. It's just going to allow you to fit that perfectly to your mechanics. Like, I might need to start a bit higher up, Lou might need to start a bit higher down. The way to test this is stand in the middle and go naturally like that with no weight, and then work out, okay, where do I need those cables to come from? You're just perfectly aligning it with where your arm wants to go again. So again, instead of doing, you'll see people doing like close grip push downs. Inefficient, going to cause issues up the arm. With this, you can adjust it perfectly to make sure it's fitting your mechanics. So if we look at Lou here, that cable, it's almost perfectly aligned from this side. You see that cable is perfectly aligned with his arm as it extends. You can ask them much better. So that's your push workout done with me and Lewy. We're gonna go head to the beach now, so we'll catch you in a bit.